Hi, my name is Federico, and I'm a fourth-year PhD student at UC Riverside in Dr. Fabio Pasquality's lab. In this video, I will walk you through our work titled Data-Driven Meets Geometric Control. This work has application to the study of zero dynamics, subspace stabilization, and malicious attacks in linear systems. When we work with linear systems, we have many representations that we can use to express the input-output relationship of the system, and therefore to study its properties and to design controllers. One of such approaches is that of the time domain, where the input-output relationship of the system is described through a state X. Another one is that of the frequency domain, where we can use the poles and zeros of the system through a transfer function. And finally, the geometric approach is perhaps a less well-known but still very powerful approach that leverages the invariant subspaces of the system to infer its properties. Now, what all these approaches have in common is the underlying assumption of a model of the system. Now, this might not always be the case, and when a model is not available, perhaps we can instead collect data, and we can always go from a data-based representation to a model-based representation through system identification, which would allow us to find matrices A, B, and C, or the poles and zeros of the system from data. However, what people have been working on recently is the so-called direct data-driven approach to control, where instead of using data to perform system identification, we want to leverage data to directly study the system and perhaps design controllers for the system, again, directly through data. This is exactly what we want to do in this talk. In particular, we assume the collection of n, capital N, experiments of length t. We collect the input, output, and state trajectories of these experiments in matrices x, u, and y, also x0 and xf, collect initial and final states. Now, we're collecting this data, and I'm going to be specific later on which kind of data we use when, since we're not always going to use all types of data. So there has been a rich literature, especially recently, in the so-called direct data-driven control approach. Here, I'm highlighting some of the most popular problems and the most productive groups, and I'm also trying to separate optimization-based solutions, which are usually computed in the behavioral approach through optimization-based problems, such as usually based on LMIs, and closed-form solutions. Also, this work here is going to leverage some closed-form solutions to our problem. So some of the problems that people have been looking at are optimal control, such as traditional LQR, robust optimization, distributed optimization, and also the problem of studying stabilizing controllers. Now, of course, there are many other problems that we might want to solve with this framework. For example, people have been touching on studying nonlinear controls, network controls, mixed model-based data-driven controls, where you might have some previous knowledge, partial at least knowledge of the system through, for example, first principle, and you want to integrate that with data. And also security in cyber-physical systems. Now, there are many problems that you can see in this as a subset of security in cyber-physical systems. For example, disturbance rejection, where we want to minimize the influence that some inputs, say age, have on our outputs. Non-interacting control, unknown input observer, where you're trying to, from an observed input, infer who generated, so which input generated that output. And also the design of undetectable attacks. Now, what these problems have in common is that they've been solved successfully in the past through the geometric approach to control. And our goal today, therefore, is to link our data-driven world to the geometric approach, therefore, basically be enabling us to solve these and many other problems through a geometric approach, but expressed in a data-based environment. Now, the study around the geometric approach started in the late 60s. And again, what I want to highlight is that the key of this approach is to leverage invariant subspaces of the state space and then to infer properties of the system from these invariant subspaces and also inform the design of eventual controllers from these subspaces. So who are these subspaces? So first of all, we need to introduce what an invariant subspace is. So given a linear map A from Rn to Rn, then we call this calligraphic V an A control, an A invariant subspace, if this subset inclusion holds. Now, this means that if X, your state at times t, belongs to V, which is an A invariant subspace, then X at t plus 1 will also belong to an A invariant subspace. Now, of course, we're dealing with dynamical systems with inputs, so we need to generalize this notion, and we can do that through AB controlled invariant subspaces, where on top of matrix A, now you also have subspace B, which is the image of the input matrix in general. And now V is we call an AB controlled invariant if this subset inclusion holds. Now, this has a very intuitive algebraic meaning, which is that if V is an AB controlled invariant, then we can always find a feedback of the state F such that V is invariant with respect to A plus BF, that is an AB controlled invariant. Now, among all the AB controlled invariants in our system, we're interested in V star, which is the maximal AB controlled invariant contained in calligraphic C. And calligraphic C, we make the null space of our output matrix. So the geometric meaning of this, again, is pretty intuitive. If we have a dynamical system evolving in discrete time like this one, and we pick calligraphic B to be the image of our input matrix, calligraphic C to be the null space of our output matrix. If X not belongs to V star, then since V star is a control invariant, then X1 can also be containing V star, X2 will be containing V star. We can always find an input that will keep our trajectory inside of V star. But since V star is also contained in a null space of C, then the output is always going to be zero. So how do we usually compute V star? Well, if we have a model of the system, we can use this recursive computation. This algorithm converges in a finite number of steps, and however, it has some issues. For example, it's recursive in nature. It inherits the limitation of the system ID method that we might use. So if we don't have a model of the system, but we want to perform system ID, then we have some assumption depending on the system ID method that we're using. For example, some assume that the system is controllable and or observable, which might not always be ideal for our study. Further, if the data is collected with noise, the geometric approach is unfortunately well known to be sensible to model uncertainty, and therefore this computation usually will not work when data is collected through noise and we have imprecisions in what A, B, and C are. So what our solution to this, V star, to finding V star instead, is simply this. So if we collect enough data such that X on U is full row rank, X naught on U is full row rank, then V star can be found as simply this matrix multiplication. Now, I want to highlight a few things of this solution. One, we're not making any assumption on the nature of the system. It doesn't have to be controllable, doesn't have to be observable. Second, the kind of data that we use is really limited. We're not using input data and we're not using state trajectories. We're only using the initial states. Now you might think, well, we're using U here, right? So it's true, you need U to be full row rank. However, this is easy to verify, for example, when data is generated through random initial conditions and inputs, and or when data is enough for which you can assume that U is in fact a full row rank. So you have a big number of experiments, this improbability will be satisfied. So how do we get to this? I don't want to go through a full proof of this result. However, I want to give you an intuition. And that is, since the system is linear, if y is, again, all our output trajectories that were generated through different experiments, then we can take a linear combination of them, say alpha, and we also know that this is generated through the observability and forcing matrices that we don't know. However, y times alpha is also going to be equal to this time alpha. In turn, this means that a new output trajectory y of t will be generated by initial condition x naught times alpha and inputs u times alpha. Again, we don't know the observability and the forcing matrices here, but we just know that this indeed holds. Now, since we know that v star is always invisible at the output, then a necessary condition is that y of t needs to be zero. Therefore, alpha needs to belong to the null space of y. Also, we know that initial condition is x naught times alpha. So we know that for sure v star has to be a subset of x naught times the null space of y. And again, this is, I believe, a very intuitive and straightforward result. We need to go into a bit, of course, more details, and I encourage you to take a look at the paper to actually prove that v star is equal to that subspace as long as t is greater or equal than n. Now, we find a similar data-driven representation for s star. Again, x naught, xf, this is all data, and r star, which are two of the three key invariant subspaces typical of the geometric approach. Why are they so important? Well, you can learn a lot from the system by simply knowing these three subspaces. For example, we know that if R star contains only the origin, then the system is left invertible. If V star plus S star equal the whole state space, then the system is right invertible. And these are only a few of many properties that we can infer from the knowledge of V, S, and R star. Another result that we give in the paper, for example, is how can we find the feedback F such that if V is an AB controlled invariant, then A plus BF is always such that V is invariant with respect to A plus BF. So how do we find this F? Can we find it through data? The answer is yes. In the paper, we give a solution. Again, this is a closed form solution. It's a bit involved. You can see it's a bit long. This gamma is the result of an optimization problem that, again, we solved and we're able to solve in closed form. And V here is a basis for the control invariant subspace calligraphic V. Now, finally, I think a very cool application of these results is the design of undetectable attacks. So now the game for an attacker is to find an additive attack A such that the input of the system does not change, whereas the state of the system changes. So if now the system is, say, a power plant, and y is the output that you're observing of the power plant, and x is the internal state of the plant, then if an attack is invisible at the output, means that whoever is monitoring the system won't notice any change. But if the attack is well designed, the state will change and perhaps be harmful to the system itself. So what we do in the paper is that we show that if our attack belongs to the subspace, again, function of data alone, this is all data, R is a basis of R star, then the outputs generated by U are going to be equal to the outputs generated by U plus A. So at the output, whether or not you're using A is not detectable. However, X is going to change. So the outputs are going to be the same, but the inputs are not going to be the same. So we see this in a very simple simulation where a system is evolving with some inputs that we're giving, no attacks up until time t. And you see that it was reaching an equilibrium here, but then we're driving it away through an attack. And you can see that it's going to some perhaps unhealthy state space, whereas the output keeps on evolving just as it would have if no attack was present. And I think it's pretty clear from the output that it's going on to its natural evolution, whereas the state is clearly drifting away from where it was supposed to be. So this is all from our presentation today. I hope you like this work, and I really encourage you to check out the paper. I also encourage you to check out our websites for more information on our work on data-driven controls and on controls in general. Ciao.